you, Michelle. I will just go ahead and introduce Hans Hensler, our lecturer for today on forensics and cybersecurity. Hans is a senior advisor at the Netherlands Forensic Institute and also a part-time professor in digital forensics and discovery at the University of Applied Sciences, Leiden. He's also a member of the board of the Netherlands Register of Court Experts and a chairman of the board of directors, and DFRWS, which I can see on your background as well. So please, Hans, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Calliope and Michelle, for introducing me. It's an honor to present today at the third Indian Dutch Summer School. And I've been asked to address you about the topic of digital forensics and cybersecurity. So let me start sharing my screen. And I expect that you now see my first slide. I see that Calliope is muted, but if she doesn't hear me, I think she will unmute and tell me that she's not hearing. Forensic and cybersecurity is a very broad topic. I think digital forensics is a large area, and in cybersecurity, of course, there's also the task of making your network secure. What I will tell to you today, what I will present about is more, so when the security has been breached, how do you investigate? How do you find digital traces that can help you reconstruct what happened? But before I dive in, let me tell you a little bit about myself. So at the moment, currently, I work as a part-time professor on the topic of digital forensics and e-discovery at the University of Applied Sciences, Leiden. This is where we have a bachelor program on forensic IT. And we are very fortunate to also have a forensic lab at the HSD in The Hague. So this is where we coordinate, where we have students investigating, etc. My full-time job is being a senior advisor at the Netherlands Forensic Institute. Some of you may know the Forensic Institute. It's quite well known. The Department of Forensic Computer Investigations or Forensic Computer Science already exists for, I would say, almost 30 years. And they do a lot of work on digital forensics. Not only, I would say, in cyber, but also digital forensics for law enforcement. For example, when it's when computers are seized or mobile phones and data is extracted for the investigations. Currently, besides these paid jobs, I also have some other affiliations. For example, what Calliope mentioned, I'm a member of the Netherlands Register of Court Experts of the board. I will touch upon that later in my presentation as well. And I'm chairman of the DFRWS board of directors. I will also show you where to find that. And Calliope is right, my background is from one of the conferences where I was a leader of a, they call it a birds of a feather discussion, where different topics in the area of digital forensics are being addressed. I have quite some experience in the field of forensics, in the field of information management, and more particular e-discovery. So it's the NFI, the TNO, which is the Netherlands Organization of Applied Research, Zylab, which is a commercial company, document management and e-discovery, PricewaterhouseCoopers, where I headed the Eurofirms group of forensic technology, where we supported forensic accountants. Before I was a professor at Leiden University of Applied Sciences, I was also a professor at the Amsterdam University of Applied Sciences. Fox IT, which is a quite well-known company founded in the Netherlands, currently part and owned by the NCC group in the UK. TraxInspector, which is a commercial company where we developed a product that started at Fox IT. And my the last 2 years, I worked at Magnet Forensics, which is a Canadian company that builds forensic digital investigation tools, and that acquired TraxInspector, the product that I worked on. But as of summer this year, I joined again the NFI, where I'm working on a big data platform for forensic investigations. My background is computer science. I also have a PhD on neural networks. And I would say that during all the different jobs I did, I always look at forensics, but also, you know, after having solved the challenge of how do you get the data out, you end up with lots of data. And I think you can use artificial intelligence and these days deep neural networks to connect the dots or to investigate and to see how information can be combined. And I think we'll see some examples in my presentation of how this might be useful in the work that you need to do. I have 1 hour. I will split it in a couple of sections. First of all, I felt it was good to take an example of a cyber incident. And I've selected Project Fontana. I'll tell about what happened, how evidence was collected, and how the investigators went about reconstructing the attack. It's more as an introduction, I think, for you, so that you have a good picture with what might happen in reality. And then I'll continue into digital forensics. And the way I'd like to discuss that is using the eDiscovery reference model, or the EDRM. And I think eDiscovery is slightly different topic than cyber crime or digital forensics in cybersecurity. But I think most of the models that you see, they have great overlap. So in this case, also the EDRM is very well suited to describe which steps you have to take in an investigation. And finally, because I don't think I will be able to tell everything in 1 hour, I have a slide which I will share with you. And if you have some time, I will go to the several URLs that are on that slide to give you some more background and resources where you can find more information if you want to get further into this field. So let's start with Project Fontana. And it's quite recent. So just before Christmas 2019, Maastricht University in the Netherlands was hit by a cyber attack, which involved ransomware. The attack took down all of the university systems. Staff and students were unable to use their email programs, and the university's research activities were also seriously disrupted. And this is, I have to say, sadly, this happens to not just the University of Maastricht, but to many other companies and organizations. And if you look at the newspapers, there is always somewhere somebody's being a victim of ransomware. And in this case, as you can see in the screenshot that I made from a website in English, Maastricht University actually paid the ransom to the hackers to decrypt their files. Unfortunately, in this case, that was successful. There are also cases, of course, where you pay and you don't get the keys to decrypt, so you lose money and you lose all your data. Interestingly for you, I think, is that Maastricht University decided to share what happened. They actually organized an afternoon where they informed everybody exactly what happened, what they did, what steps they took, to educate other people into this field, into what to do with an incident, to give them an objective view of what you can do and the findings that they learned. And the money they paid Fox IT to investigate and to write a report that was actually also made publicly accessible. There are more like this. For example, personally, I was involved when I worked at Fox IT from 2010 to 2014. In 2012, we had Project Black Tulip, which was the DigiNotar incident. I will not go into details. I will mention it a couple of times, but also the Black Tulip report, the DigiNotar incident, where finally the Dutch government was the client of Fox IT, decided to make this report of the breach and the investigation public. So this might also contain some interesting information. The good thing about the Black Tulip report is that it is in English, whereas the Project Fontana, the Maastricht University ransomware attack, is in Dutch. There is an English summary though. And I've translated some relevant parts of the report in my slides here. So it will help you understand basically what happened. So first step in this kind of thing, where you get a phone call. I think it was on December 23rd, so just before Christmas. Everybody is on holiday. Fox ID gets a phone call. We are being hacked. We are, our servers are being held ransom. And Fox IT is a company that is well informed about what happens in the cybersecurity world and also in the dark web, in the underground. And they were, I think, I have to assume, because I'm not working with Fox IT anymore, so all the information I'm going to present to you is actually taken from me from the report. I did not do any interviews, so it's just based on all open source information. And in the report, you can read that Fox IT identified the perpetrator of this ransomware attack as the Dardex Red Group. Red typically is a short for remote access tools. And they recognized it because it was a ransomware attack in a Microsoft Windows domain environment, which is might seem general, but it's already pretty specific. And they already knew by December 2019 that over the year, over the course of 2019, 150 victims are known which show a very similar modus of operandi. MO. and how does it look like? How does it modus operandi look like? So how do they? How does their method work? How does the method of the Dardex Red Group work? First, they use phishing emails to infect one or more systems. That's step one. Step two is they identify the target organization. So what is this organization? How does their network look like? Three, to do that, they start moving laterally through the network. So from the infected workstations to which they get access, they try to move to other workstations, typically servers, to get more access to other systems. They delete or encrypt backups. They try to roll out the ransom software across as many servers in the network, and then they demand ransom by email. So these are basically, based on this, they recognized how the group acts. And this is already a good starting point if you want to investigate. So you might get a phone call from Maastricht University saying, we've been hacked, we cannot access our files anymore. Based on basic information, you start forming a scenario, a hypothesis, you start testing that. And this is an important step in the investigation because Maastricht University is large, much larger, for example, than back in 2012 when we investigated DigiNotar. So where do you start? And all of this, and I will share the links later, or I think the PDF version of my presentation will be shared or will be available to anybody who wants to have it. And you can see the links and check for the, at least for the English summary of the report. So what you can read about the investigation in Project Fontana is that Fox IT took a couple of steps, or their work consisted of a number of things they did. First of all, they collect digital evidence from sources in a network, and this is an important part of every digital forensics investigation, regardless if it's cybersecurity or if it's some other investigation. Also very typical, in the beginning, you don't know very much. You have some ideas, you have an hypothesis, but never you will get all the data. So the collection of digital evidence proceeds as you are going through the investigation process. And as you get new insights, you will ask new data. And this is done incrementally, as we will see also, and as you can read in the report. Fox IT is a forensic lab, so whenever they collected a batch of evidence, it was uploaded to the forensic lab of Fox IT, where it was being investigated. Because there is so much data, you try to restrict your data collection to what they call indicators of compromise. Indicators of compromise, IOCs for short, means that in the systems, in the Windows operating system, or in your backup, or the network traffic, or your firewall, there might be specific indications that point to this particular attack. Or if malware has been installed, there might be specific registry keys that are unusual for a unaffected compared to an unaffected workstation. If you can recognize these indicators, that's a strong point, or that's a good lead to start investigating which other computers in my network are infected. And if you find this, you can collect the data. But also, when you are investigating the compromise, you might find other indicators of a second compromise or a different type of compromise. When you know those IOCs and you've described them, you can use them also. Others can also use them to protect themselves against this attack. So in the report from Project Fontana, you can read that IOCs have been shared and you can anonymize them. So you can define and describe an IOC without having to reveal sensitive or confidential information about the victim company or organization, which might be important. And I know in the Netherlands, we have government instances that protect critical infrastructure. So they would be very interested in knowing the IOC, so they can check immediately if other organizations or companies in the Netherlands have been victimized from this attack. Because as we will see, the university, they realized that they were being attacked on December 23, but as we will see from the investigation, the attack actually started 2 months earlier in October. So it might very well be that other organizations are also under attack, but they just haven't been, they just haven't come to the stage where they are being, where their files are being held hostage. So what happened? And this is October 2019. What they found is that the malware was downloaded from an external internet IP address, and the malware is called SDBot. And that was executed on multiple systems inside the network of the university. And once activated, so this is also called a dropper, this little piece of software then downloaded additional packets from an external website that came persistent on the Windows computers. And on the right, you see screenshots that also have been shared. They have been redacted, so they don't show all the information, but this is a typical phishing email. So as discussed, blah, 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 please click this link. And you might think, well, it doesn't work. This is not happening in my company or in my organization. But this is why many of the cybersecurity awareness trainings, or when companies start to prepare themselves, awareness is an important part of making your company or organization aware of the potential of these phishing emails. And the second has an attachment. So if people open the attachments, they activate the macro, and the macro actually, so you don't have to click a link. The opening the Excel sheet is already an action that makes yourself vulnerable to the attackers. And basically by doing that, the dropper downloads additional software. It downloads a tool that installs itself on the Windows machine. It makes itself persistent, meaning that if you shut down your computer, you start it the next day, the software is still there. And it hides itself. So it's not easily to spot if the software is active. And virus checkers might do that, and Windows and firewalls might detect some strange activity, which actually happened, but in some cases they don't. So October it started. What happened in November? So in November, what the investigation shows and reveals is that the attacker starts spreading through the network. So the software the SDBot downloaded is MetaPerter, and it's used by attackers to infect to access infected desktop computers. And these desktop computers can be physical computers, but the University of Maastricht also has many virtual computers. They can also infect virtual computers. And approximately after 1 week, the attackers gain access to servers in the network, where they also install MetaPerter. And they install PowerSploit. And PowerSploit is a collection of PowerShell scripts that can be used to test the security of a network. So that's, those are legal scripts, you can use them to test the security and to fix it. But of course, it can also be used by an attacker that wants to know what vulnerabilities exist in the network of the University of Maastricht. It's also, you know, networks can be complicated. These are big networks. I have an overview. I think that more than 8,000 computers were part of the Maastricht University network. And Pingcastle is a software program that's installed that you can install in a virtual workstation. And it pings through the network. And it can help you visualize the Active Directory of the university network. An Active Directory is, I would say, a directory in the computer system that's used by the IT staff to manage resources, to manage permissions, who is on the network, which users are there, which computers are there. So if you have access to the Active Directory, and you find out where firewalls are, where routers are, you get a pretty good picture of how the network is structured, and ideally also of where the interesting servers are. And if you are a ransomware attacker and you want to be effective, you preferably want to encrypt critical systems to the university. So email server, backup servers, databases that are, you know, with results of students, maybe with grades. So if you are able to, the backups, for example, where are systems being backupped? If you can encrypt the backups, if you can encrypt the production systems, then as a ransomware attacker, you are in a good position to negotiate ransomware. And so it happened that at the end of November, the attacker is finally able to obtain network admin privileges using the account administrator.unimas. And why is this important? Because until that moment, they were only using local permissions, or they were using the permissions of a user that was entrapped by the phishing emails. And typically, normal users don't have much access. They don't have much privileges. They cannot access network resources. So once you are able to gain admin privileges, then you have much more possibilities to really go and install software on more systems. So that's actually what happened in December. And, the attacker was preparing the ransomware attack in December. They used the domain admin account to further explore the Active Directory, the network structure, and just before Christmas, they really start preparing the ransomware attack, which is basically an IT admin work, because you want to install software across the network, which is typically what normal system administrators also do if they want to send out a new version of, for example, Microsoft Office or of some other tool, or a new version of the virus antivirus software. They also switched off Windows Defender on all the systems, so they would not be blocked. And basically, after they hit go, in 25 minutes, all files at 267 servers were encrypted, which also included the backup servers. And that, I think, was the moment on 23rd of December when the university decided to call Fox IT. So it's interesting then to see what they collected. This is all taken again from the report. So what you see here is an overview of the system data that was collected. So it took some time, but you see that on December 30th, they took disk and RAM images of one of the computers, that or 321 computers. The memory, because some of those infected systems, they will not be on the file system, on the hard disk, but they will stay in memory. And as you can see, this continues. So then in two parts, they collected data from 360 systems. First time on January 2nd, second time on January 14th. And I expect that, for example, this was probably in their investigation in the first half of January, they found some new indicators of compromise. So they decided to acquire more data from those systems. And a hardware, hard disk in a computer typically is large. From servers, it's even bigger. So if you want to move quickly in your investigation, if you want to do it fast, you don't collect all of the data. Because making a forensic hard disk copy, especially from servers that may have terabytes, is a slow process. You have to be physically there, or if you do it over the network, it takes more time because the network is restricted. So Fox IT targeted and they knew exactly what data to collect. But knowing what data to collect is also based on what you expect and what you suspect. So as the suspicion grows, as you are getting more information about the nature of the attack, you may decide to get additional data. You see there's, and this is all redacted in the report, so we don't have the exact workstation names, but and from the system there will be physical workstations, there will be virtual workstation. Here you see they already in January 2nd they get to the domain controller, which was obviously under attack, to more servers, etc. They took more evidence. They collected log files, they connected network data and miscellaneous files. So the network data, obviously the firewall logs are interesting to see what kind of network traffic was there. They took a disk image on the December 30th from the first workstation. They took a copy of encrypted files. They took a sample of the malware so they could investigate. They investigated the APO database. I'm not sure, it's not explained in the report what it is, but it might be related to patents, so intellectual property. They took forensic copies of the mailboxes. I assume those were mailboxes from the first infections in October. But of course, when they started investigating in at Christmas, they didn't really know what happened. So during your investigation, you find out, okay, so this must have been by this person. We're going to collect the mailbox and see if we can trace back, if we can still find the phishing emails that were actually causing the cyber incident. Apparently, the university was using Splunk to manage notifications from DNS requests, the domain controller, file system events, Windows event logs. This is quite common. You will see this in many more organizations. They're using Splunk, which is a big data approach for collecting different monitoring and audit logging from critical applications in your system. So that's a good source to get data from. So what I did, I took those events, and it's not easy to read this, but just to give you an idea, I sorted this by date because you find different types of data were collected at different types. So I'm not quite sure if you can see my mouse, but here on January 2nd, you see the first collection of forensic artifacts from 360 systems. And January 14, you see the second part of the collection. So Fox IT was called at Christmas. First data was received December 30th, and it took at least until a couple of months. So the February 3rd, even they got two more servers, the disk images from servers, which is typical. So then they started investigating, and they were so nice also to include this in the report. So in the report you can find this overview, which is basically the outcome of their investigation, so the timeline of important events. And this is an important result because this helps you really understand what went on. So now from the investigation they learned that October 15 there was the first infection. October 2nd, 16th, one day later, the second infection was there. They could trace back and see that the same day, the 16th of October, there was the first manual activity from the attacker. A day later, he was able to compromise the first server. A week later, some malware called PowerView was detected by Windows Defender. It was removed. So we don't know how many other instances were there that were not removed, but apparently this was part of the modus operandi. Then it's probably things happen during the next month, but in the report they mention November 21st as the first time that the attacker compromises a server and gains access to an account with domain admin rights. And using that domain account, they log into a domain controller. And when you are in the domain controller, then you can further investigate what happens. And then, especially in December, when they really have figured out the network, probably when they know where to hit the hardest, they are detected a couple of times by McAfee antivirus software. And this is a problem that you see in many more organizations. There are so many alarms that, because you would think, so why not on December 19th do you realize you're under attack? Because there's, I think it's because there's often many false alerts. It's becoming holiday season. It took another 4 days for alerts to become more serious, finally not getting access to the systems. So in those days, the attack, the ransomware software installation was further prepared, and it hit and started off at December 23rd, just before six. So in all of that would be like starting on, not the day before Christmas, but the day before that. I think that's what happened. On the 30th, so Fox was called on the 24th, although that same evening, but in the night, and the 30th of December, the Maastricht University received the decryption key from the attacker. So they requested the key, but still, of course, you want to investigate what really happened to make sure that, because this is often, this might happen and has happened, that you pay ransom, you get your files back, and maybe sometime later when the hacker needs more money, they encrypt your software again, or they encrypt your files again. So it's really important. And this, I think this is one of the important things of your forensic investigation, is that you find out what happened. And if you really know for sure that all malware has been removed, that you know who did it, how they came in. And as you can read in the report, as it with any other case, most important for Maastricht University was that they would gain access to their files again. And how, as much as important the forensic investigation is, the first priority of Fox IT was restoring normal operation. And this is always a challenge in forensic investigations, in cyber incidents, is that you are being challenged with maybe, you know, if you have to restore normal operations, the simplest thing to do would be to wipe out all systems, reinstall them, or restore backups. But that would also mean losing evidence. So there's a fine balance between taking data, taking the time to forensically collect data, and restoring normal operation. And I think it was because of the fact that they paid the ransom, they got the keys,